Good morning. It's my great pleasure that this morning I can introduce to you Professor Emmanuel Falk, coming from Paris, from Catholic Institute. He originally specialized in patristic and medieval philosophy and theology, but today his focus is on the philosophy of religion, which he also teaches. And for the hermeneutics, it is important that he is married and father of four children. Emmanuel Falk, in his work, tries to open philosophy and phenomenology to challenges coming from other disciplines, such as theology and recently from psychoanalysis. He has widely opened the door to the theology. This strategy was named in French, Passer le Rubicon, and this is also presented in one of his books. The title of the book is Passer le Rubicon, Philosophy and Theology, an Essay on the Frontiers, Essay sur les Frontières. Donc, he lets theology to challenge the phenomenology, he lets psychoanalysis to challenge the phenomenology. And this is also the topic of his last book on Freud in Phenomenology, appeared only 2 days ago, called Ça n'a rien à voir, Lire Freud en philosophie. From this point of view, he argues that the experience of the thought is fundamentally the thought of experience. One other book called Le Livre de l'Expérience. He presented the dialogue between the phenomenology and the theology, which are interactive, in his trilogy entitled Le Tridium Philosophique. Originally, these books were published separately, but they are also gathered in one book, Le Tridium Philosophique. His books are translated in multiple languages, such as English, Italian, Spanish, Russian, German. There are also several books, which discuss his work. The title of his presentation today calls Which Hermeneutics for Today? Philosophy and Theology, New Frontiers. And I invite you, Professor Falk, to present your presentation.
So thanks, Peter, for the presentation. You bought all the books. Take it with you, okay? And thanks, Branko, for this invitation. I'm very happy to be here with you in Slovenia. It is the first time I'm coming, and I met many of you in Vienna. It was only a few months ago. So, Branko Kluun asked me when I was in Vienna, I said, you have to speak about hermeneutics. I said, okay, I will try to speak about hermeneutics, but hermeneutics is not my first subject, because I'm speaking more about philosophy of religion, phenomenology. And my idea today is to develop my position, my confrontation between my work and Paul Ricoeur. In fact, I spoke many times about Paul Ricoeur. Paul Ricoeur is important in my work, but I never wrote a text only on Paul Ricoeur. So I thought it is the occasion to make a point about my position in front of Paul Ricoeur and the question of hermeneutics. So, the true title is Radicalization of Hermeneutics, a Confrontation with Paul Ricoeur, Radicalization of Hermeneutics. So, I would like first to ask three questions in introduction in the beginning of this lecture. Three questions which are coming from Paul Ricoeur. The first question I would like to raise is a question of what Paul Ricoeur called the short route and the long route. You know, he spoke about that, of the short paths and the long path. I think it's a very important question for today. Paul Ricoeur said, in existence and hermeneutics, in a conflict of interpretation, existence and hermeneutics is a text he wrote in 1965, And he said, substituting of the short route of analytic of Dasein, the long route that begin by analysis of language. And it is very clear in that text that Paul Ricoeur confronts on one way the hermeneutics of life or the hermeneutics of facticity, hermeneutics of life in Husserl of hermeneutics of facticity in Heidegger, against an hermeneutics of text, an hermeneutics of language, an hermeneutics of history, in the same way of Gadamer, for example. And Paul Ricoeur said that the question of mediations is a very important question, and the question of confrontation with other disciplines. And today, me, now, I'm trying to confront phenomenology to other disciplines, not to give lessons to the other discipline, to explain what theology has to do, what psychoanalysis has to do, but how the other discipline can change ourselves. What I called crossing the Rubicon, it is in the two ways. The philosopher can become a theologian, and the theologian can transform the philosopher. And in that last book, it is exactly the same from Freud. It is not to, this book, ça n'a rien à voir, doesn't mean that there is no link between philosophy and psychoanalysis. It means that I can't see the ça. En français, ça n'a rien à voir, it is impossible to see the ça. And what does it mean that it is impossible to see the id? It means that the question of the id in Freud has to ask a question to ourselves, which is a question of the sense of the a priori of meaning, of the a priori of signification in hermeneutics and phenomenology. So, my first question is what we have to do today about the short path or the short route and the long route. Can we stay only in the hermeneutic of life or hermeneutics of facticity, even if the hermeneutics of life and the hermeneutics of facticity is absolutely the departure of my work? The second question, and then just to finish this first question, behind this question of the short route and the long route, there is the question of the graft of hermeneutics on phenomenology, la greffe, very well known. And do we have to say today that hermeneutics is phenomenology and vice versa, which is exactly the thesis, the position of Claude Romano, you know him, a good friend of us. And so, why Claude Romano is speaking about hermeneutics so much? And why we're speaking about hermeneutics is absolutely speaking about phenomenology. It is no more a graft. So what does it mean, an hermeneutics, which is phenomenology and vice versa? The second question I would like to raise is, in front of Paul Ricoeur, is the question of the first experience and the question of the status of experience, a question I develop in my book, The Book of Experience. Because today, I think that many philosophers of my generation are working for Merleau-Ponty, on Merleau-Ponty, and Merleau-Ponty is coming from this very well-known sentence of Husserl in the Cartesian Meditation on the paragraph 16 about what we call the mute experience, l'expérience muette. I quote Husserl, "The first is the pure experience, and one might say, mute still, to be brought to express its own meaning." Le premier, c'est l'expérience pure, l'expérience muette qui attend d'atteindre, d'apparaître à son propre sens. So, the mute experience, I think it is exactly the beginning of my work about body. Probably it is the beginning of the work of Claude Romano too, when he's speaking about the heaven and hermeneutics and phenomenology, Debra and so on. But so, I agree with Husserl and Merleau-Ponty to begin with this question of the mute experience, what you can call the hermeneutic of life or an hermeneutics of body, which is not first an hermeneutic of language. That's why in Bonaventure, the book of the word is coming before the book of scripture. And you know that in Bonaventure, if there is a book of scripture, it is only because of the scene, because in a Catholic hermeneutic, you don't need to have the scripture first, And that is the difference between Ricoeur and what I want to do, because Ricoeur is Protestant, I am Catholic. I will just say a few words about Catholic hermeneutics and the Protestant hermeneutic of Ricoeur and the Jewish hermeneutic of Levinas, which are different. But my question today is, in front of Ricoeur and this question of hermeneutic, is that true that all mute experience has to be expressed its own meaning? So for me, there is a question in phenomenology and for phenomenology today, which is the question of meaning. Why are we always looking for meaning? A question I raise to phenomenology in intentionality, and a question I raise in hermeneutics in interpretation. Of course, you can say phenomenology didn't reach always the question of meaning. You can read Michel Henry and so on. But I will show you, or I can discuss with you about that. I explain it in a long note in the book on Freud, that in Michel Henry, there is not an a priori of meaning or a priori of sense, but there is always an a priori of phenomenalization. So the question for me, the second question I would like to raise, is the question of the reach of meaning. Why are we always looking for this question of meaning? What is an hermeneutics of the impossibility of hermeneutics? I know when you say that, it seems to be close to Derrida and so on, but okay, I know. But it's not the question. The question is, in fact, it is more close to Henri Maldinet and the question of madness, for example, and the question of psychiatric question, the question of behavior. It's absolutely not a question of language for me. But it is what I call, in a text I just published in English, and it will be published in the Revue de Métaphysique et Morale in the next number, in September, a text I call hors phénomène. It has been translated the extra phenomenon. What does that mean, hors phénomène? Is it possible to think hors phénomène? And I will try to show you that in my relationship with Ricoeur, but also with Jean-Luc and Heidegger, that there is three solutions in front of Kant, but perhaps there is a fourth one. Wow, how is that? The third question, so the first question is about the short way and the long way. The second question is about the status of the meaning and the first experience. Huh? Is it a mute experience? Yes. But do we have to wait that this experience is booked to express to its meaning? And the third question is a question in front of Ricoeur, of the link or the relationship between finitude and fallibility. And that point is about his book, The Fallible Man, the volume 1 of Finitude and Culpability in 1960. Because Paul Ricoeur gave a course during one semester on that book. I discussed a lot about that book with my student in PhD. And Paul Ricoeur said, I quote, "First, it turned out that the initial guiding concept of such an anthropology is not and cannot be that of finitude. In this dialectic, finitude is a result and not the origin." So of course, I can't agree with this position, because for me it's absolutely clear that in all my books, finitude is an origin and not a result. It is absolutely the inverse, because the beginning is a question of finitude for me, and it is not a result. Only in a theological perspective, it means about because of the resurrection, which is the metamorphosis of finitude. So, why Ricoeur is saying that finitude can't be an origin and only a result, and what is my position in front of Ricoeur about that point? So I would like to raise three points. First point, the question of the short route and the long route. I will just synthesis the third chapter of Crossing the Rubicon. Then the second question is the question of to think something which is hors phénomène, outside the phenomena, hors. Is that translated extra phenomenal? But I don't know how. And then the third question is the question of finitude of infallibility. Those three questions are coming, in fact, from the three hypertrophy of phenomenology diagnostic in the wedding feast of the lamb, which is the hypertrophy of the flesh on the body. That's why, what about the body? Huh? I wrote a paper on Henri, which is either flesh or the body. Then the hypertrophy of the sense on no sense, or I prefer to say the hypertrophy of meaning, excuse me, of meaning on chaos. And then the third one is the hypertrophy of passivity on activity. It means, what about force today? Strength, a question that Derrida raised to phenomenology, and in fact, Gilles Deleuze too. So, the first point, the hypothesis of a Catholic hermeneutic. So, I will speak fast about it because it is a point I developed in Vienna, but I don't want to repeat what I said, I'm not coming to say the same thing. But it is the first position I developed in front of Paul Ricoeur. I just want to say that I realized when I studied theology that when I was in philosophy, I never hear anything about Paul Ricoeur. And Jean-Luc knows that, but Paul Ricoeur was absolutely not studied. In France, when I was at the university, nobody was speaking about Paul Ricoeur. And when I came at the Catholic Institute of Paris and the Centre Sèvres in theology, all the teachers were speaking about Paul Ricoeur. In fact, Paul Ricoeur is not really a partner. We don't discuss with Paul Ricoeur. Jean-Luc discussed with Paul Ricoeur, but just only on his text on hermeneutics, last one. And Michel Henry never discussed with Paul Ricoeur. Jean-Luc Chrétien never discussed with Paul Ricoeur. Michel Henry never discussed with Paul Ricoeur. And you can ask to yourself, why they don't discuss with Paul Ricoeur? Because Ricoeur has been welcome where I am, the Catholic Institute of Paris. That's why you have an amphitheater, Paul Ricoeur. But in fact, absolutely not where I was, in the University of Nanterre, in Sorbonne, so at this time. Because today, everyone is speaking about Paul Ricoeur in the State University in France, but not the Paul Ricoeur of hermeneutics, but the Paul Ricoeur of the question of Hegel or fallibility, exactly what Camille Riquet and so on are doing. The other generation. But why? And then in my book, Crossing the Rubicon, I realized that Paul Ricoeur has been very important, the text has been very important. And when I studied theology, I have to study Paul Ricoeur. And the first text I studied, it is the hermeneutical function of distanciation. And you know that text has been published in 1975. Where Paul Ricoeur explained that you have to make, to operate a triple reduction or epoche, the epoche on the author, the epoche on the reader, and the epoche of the referent. And it is very important because thanks to Ricoeur to help us to go out from the historical critical exegesis. Because as I explained in Crossing the Rubicon, the historical critical exegesis is like the literal sense of scripture, because it is a question of the reference. And Ricoeur said, you have to stop now with the literal sense of scripture. You have to stop to say you have to be very intelligent to understand the Genesis with the two story and so on. But a text is a sort of unity, and the most important point is the tropological sense. I quote Ricoeur: the appropriation of the text, the application to the situation of the reader. How can I understand myself in front of the text? The text is the medium through which we understand ourselves. So you see that this is absolutely the tropological meaning of scripture. Okay, and do we have to continue to develop only that way? That is the question, because we are doing the same thing for 20 years. I know that many of you made some PhD on Paul Ricoeur, and it's good. I'm absolutely not against Paul Ricoeur. But do we have to always repeat Paul Ricoeur? It's the same thing on Paul Ricoeur, which is only the question of the text. So, me, my suggestion is to say that today we don't have to develop the literal sense of culture, which is the historical hermeneutics, historical critical hermeneutics, and not only the the tropological sense or moral sense, which is the hermeneutics of Paul Ricoeur, but what I call the allegoric sense, which is the phenomenality of the text. Exactly as Paul Claudel said in a very good book is about J'aime la Bible, when Paul Claudel said that the book of the Bible is not made for me, but I am made for it. It means that the book is not a book addressed to me, but I am addressed in the book to the book. It means that the sense of the reading of the text in the liturgy of word is exactly the same as the sense of incorporation in the Eucharist. Because when I eat the body of Christ, I become the body of Christ. So when I read the text of the Bible, I become the Bible. And Jean-Louis Chrétien show it in a small book, a very nice book, Se laisser lire par les Saintes Écritures, to be read by the Scripture, and not to read the Scripture. So, the question is the question of the phenomenality of the text. It means that the question is not to know if I can find myself in the text, but if I can be lost in the text. Because the text is strange for me, not because I recognize myself, not because the text is saying something to me, but because the text is saying nothing to me. I'm lost in the text. So, in that way, I suggest to develop an hermeneutic I call of body of voice, and distinguish between the Jewish hermeneutic of Levinas, which is an hermeneutic of the text of the body of the text, because for Levinas, God is in the letter of the text. That's a very important point. And the Protestant hermeneutic of Paul Ricoeur, which is an hermeneutic of the sense of the text, and what I call the Catholic hermeneutic in Crossing the Rubicon, which is an hermeneutic of the text of the body. Not the body of the text and the text, the sense of the text, but the text of the body. Why? Because in a Catholic hermeneutic, body is first. When I'm speaking about Catholic hermeneutic, it is absolutely not to be against the communism, absolutely not, you know. But only to say that when you are speaking, you are always speaking from an experience, even if you can't reduce what you are saying to this experience. So, my hypothesis is that the Catholic hermeneutic, but some of you know it, Crossing the Rubicon, is an hermeneutic of body and voice. And why this question of voice? Because of a sentence of Hugues of Saint-Victor, which was very important for me, when he said, "Hic intelligenda ex vox verbi quod ibi caro Dei," the voice of the word must be understood at present as the flesh of God was understood then. It means that today we can't see the body of Christ, but we can hear his voice. And what is the difference between a voice and a text? It is the fact, as said Paul Ricoeur, and in a Protestant way, that there is absolutely an autonomy of text, which need nobody. But in voice, there is no autonomy of the voice, because when you have a voice, you need a body behind the door, because someone is speaking to you, but you need a body. So there is no liturgy of word, independently of the liturgy of the Eucharist. In that way, we could develop this hermeneutic, and as say Augustine. So I developed the hypothesis not of la voix nue, the new voice, or the next voice, as said Jean-Luc Chrétien, but I developed the hypothesis of la voix crue. La voix crue in French, or they translated the raw voice. But la voix crue in French, it is to believe. So I have to believe in this voice, but it means also non-cooked. Non-cooked, because it is vociferation, proferation of the body, exactly as the Christ on the cross, when he cried, il poussa un grand cri. In fact, in Greek, it is il poussa un cri d'une grande voix, megalephone. So it is the phoné, the voice of the body. So, as I said, Augustine in the Enarrationes in Psalm North, and I'll finish on this first point in front of Ricoeur, which is a question of a Catholic hermeneutics in front of a Protestant hermeneutic of Ricoeur and Jewish hermeneutic of Levinas. So Augustine said, let us hear our voice in illo voces nostras and his voice in us. So it is, in fact, the liturgy of word is voice to voice, because I can recognize someone to his voice, exactly as Derrida showed it in his book about the voice and the phenomenon. So that is the first question. Then the second question I want to raise in front of Paul Ricoeur is the question of sense. Not the question of mandate, but of sense, or the question of meaning. The question of meaning. Do we have always to reach, to look for meanings in hermeneutics with the question of interpretation, and in phenomenology with the question of intentionality? In fact, phenomenology and hermeneutics have got a sort of affinity, which is to say that there is an a priori of meaning or an a priori of manifestation. And it is exactly what contests Maurice Merleau-Ponty just before he died, and the book Ça n'a rien à voir is coming from Merleau-Ponty first, because Merleau-Ponty is reading, he is saying in a preface to a book to Dr. Hénard, a book on Freud, and he said that the limits of the discourse has been erased by Freud in the question of the id. So, if Ricoeur wrote a book on Freud to find in Freud himself the roots of the question of interpretation, and that's why Ricoeur wrote essentially on the first topic on Freud, which is the question of symptom, interpretation, and so on, and consciousness, pre-consciousness and consciousness, the question today when we are reading Freud is not the question of interpretation, the question of meaning, but the question of no meaning. And exactly the reason why Freud changed his topic to come to his second topic, which is le ça, le moi, sur moi. So, in that way, the question is there any limits of phenomenology and limits of hermeneutics? And the confrontation with psychoanalysis, which is not the same as the confrontation with theology, of course, is this confrontation can erase this question to the philosopher himself. It means that we don't have, phenomenologists don't have to give lessons to theology, to give lessons to psychoanalysis and so on, but I have to accept to change myself because of psychoanalysis, to change myself because of theology. So you see that if the beginning of my work is the short path or the short way, which is the phenology of life or the hermeneutics of facticity, it is very clear that I am also Ricoeurian, as many people said to me, you are Ricoeurian. I said, why me? Am I Ricoeurian? And said, yes, because you accept to be transformed by the other science or disciplines. And what I explain in that book is that the Heideggerian distinction between ontic and ontology, ontic and ontologique, condemn definitively any discussion with the human science. Of course, my generation, you have to understand that in May 68, I was 5. So, I absolutely don't know what's happened. I never knew this time when everyone was speaking about Marx and everyone was speaking about Freud and so on. So for me, I'm not in this from this generation. So for me today, if I'm discussing with human science, it is absolutely not to disqualify phenomenology or something else, but only to say that we need today an alterity to change phenomenology. Exactly was what Henri Maldinet did with psychiatry, or what we can do with aesthetic, we can do it with phenomenology, with theology, with psychoanalysis, and so on. So, the second question of the status of the meaning is a question I raised in a paper, a recent paper, which is Hors Phénomène, which will be published in Revue de Métaphysique et Morale, the next number, and it's been translated and published in English under the title The Extra Phenomenon. So, my suggestion today is to distinguish after Levinas and after Maurice Blanchot, to distinguish between the phenomenology of night and the night of phenomenology. And my thesis is to say that we are always speaking about the phenomenology of night, but never about the night of phenomenology. And Levinas saw what is the night of phenomenology, but I think that in totality infinity, it changed his conception because of alterity. What is the difference between phenomenology of night and night of phenomenology? In the phenomenology of night, you can find it in Michel Henry, in Chrétien, in Jean-Luc, and so on. In phenomenology of night, you can develop the possibility of non-manifestation. But you are always looking, waiting for the manifestation. So something is non-manifest, hein, phénoménologie de l'inapparent. Something is non-manifest, but the phenomenologist is here to welcome the manifestation, for the manifestation itself is coming. But the night of phenomenology is absolutely not the same, because the night of phenomenology is not the possibility of the impossibility of the phenomenon, which is always a possibility, okay? It is not the possibility of the impossibility of the phenomenon, which is always a possibility, but it is the impossibility of the possibility of the phenomenon, which is no more a possibility. It means that there is a difference between the possibility of the apparition of the phenomenon, even if the phenomenon doesn't appear, and the impossibility for the phenomenon to appear, because there is no more horizon for the apparition of the phenomenon. It means that because of some events, it can be an event, it can be a trauma, a psychological disturbance, the death of one of my children, or something like that. When something like that happens, nothing can happen anymore. And if there is no more event, it is absolutely not because I'm not able to welcome an event. If there is no event, it is because there is no more structure to receive an event. Because some events, which are trauma, can destroy the possibility of the event itself. In fact, it is exactly the way of Henri Maldinet. And Claude Romano took a lot from this way when he spoke about effroi. In fact, it is exactly what Henri Maldinet said. It means that for the question of suffering, evil does the most harm when it no longer hurts, or when the vital conditions by which I am affected are annulled as such. I mean, le mal fait mal lorsqu'il ne fait plus mal. Because when I can't suffer anymore, it is because the possibility of suffering has been destroyed. And it is the true sense of suffering. That's why when Paul Ricoeur is speaking about evil, and he said that evil, I can't speak about evil as a concept, but I am to speak about evil because evil is the way by which I suffer something, it's not enough. The true evil is the moment when I can't suffer anymore. Exactly what said Charlotte Delbourg, for example, about Auschwitz. So, there are three interpretations of Kant, in my way, today, in phenomenology, the interpretation of Heidegger, the interpretation of Ricoeur, and the interpretation of Jean-Luc Marion. And I think it's very, very interesting to compare Ricoeur and Jean-Luc Marion at that point, because Ricoeur, in Finitude and Culpability, took exactly the same categories of Jean-Luc. It is about the same sentence in the book being given on, and in Erika, and the same sentence, the same categories, the same text in Kent. It's absolutely. So when I read Ricoeur, I said, Jean-Luc took that from Ricoeur or not? What is the discussion between finitude and culpability? When you see that, it's absolutely incredible. The discussion between fiability in Ricoeur and the saturated phenomenon in Jean-Luc's work. So first position of the philosopher in front of Kant is very well known. It is finitude and radicalization. Exactly what Heidegger did in the Kant book in 1999, when you know that he came back to the a priori forms of sensibility and to say that finitude is first. So it is a sort of radicalization of Kant, only the phenomenon and so on. This is very well known. Then, after this first position, which is radicalization and finitude, we have the second position, which is the Ricoeur's position, which is the question of fallibility and disproportion. So, Ricoeur said, I quote Ricoeur in The Fallible Man, page 134 in the English edition, our guide in this deduction of the categories of fallibility will be the Kantian triad of the categories of quality, reality, negation of limitation. So it is the categories of quality, but it's very close from Jean-Luc, who took all the categories to speak about the saturated phenomenon. And Ricoeur is working about the schematism of imagination and the table of categories. And he explained that, in fact, when you are speaking about the category of the finite, the quality, and reality, finite, and limitation, it is because of limitation. And what is the limitation in Ricoeur? It is the disproportion, he said that, between reality and finite. So it means that there is disproportion in Ricoeur. In fact, this is very close from Blondel, for example, the aspiration of the supernatural. And he said that the complete discourse on finitude is a discourse of the finitude and the infinitude of man. So what Ricoeur wants to show in his Kant's interpretation, it is the fact that there is a sort of insufficiency of man, because of course I can know only the phenomenon, but I want to think the things themselves, l'en soi. You see, the noumena. I can know only the phenomena, but I desire the noumena. So if I desire the noumena, it means that there is a difference between the phenomena and the noumena, so there is fallibility. And fallibility is, in the term of Ricoeur, I think we are speaking too much about that, of course, it is the name of fragility, of affective order, the disproportion whose exegesis we have been pursuing to me, actively, takes the name of fragility and the affective order. That's why today we are always speaking about vulnerability and so on. But me, I think vulnerability is good. But I've been, I did a stage in a center of palliative care, and you will see that it is absolutely not vulnerability. And you can't say to someone, okay, you have to welcome your husband or your wife because you welcome nothing and nobody, because there is no possibility to welcome. There is only the body. My next book will be on the palliative care and this experience. So, that is, so you see that the position of Ricoeur in front of Kant is to find in the category a sense of disproportion, and that's why there is an aeronautics, because of the disproportion, because there is a desire in me or something to happen. Then the third solution is what Jean-Luc did in being given the saturated phenomenon. Here, I would like to quote a very well-known song of Sacha Guitry. Of Sacha Guitry, Jean-Luc, no, I don't know the other way. An old singer. And the title of his song is, he said, "Woman, I am against them, totally against them." In fact, in French, c'est femme, ça, femme. Quand je suis contre, je suis tout contre. Understand that? Je suis contre. When I am against, I depends of what I am against. Okay? Exactly what Heidegger said about Nietzsche when Nietzsche is speaking about Platon, because he said that Nietzsche inverses Platon, but he depends on Platon because he inverses Platon, which is absolutely false. when you are reading Nietzsche, he never inverts Platon because it's absolutely not the same way. So we can tell that Jean-Luc said in Being Given exactly what Ricoeur said, because Ricoeur said how guide is a category's quality, and Marion, I will sketch a description of saturated phenomenon by following the lead of the category of the understanding defined by Kant. No, it is the same way, it is the same departure. But Jean-Luc suggests to invert the category. So the invisible according unbearable to quality, absolute to relation, and irregardable to modality. And of course, Jean-Luc is doing exactly what Heidegger is saying about Nietzsche in front of Platon. It is only a sort of inversion of category. It means that if Jean-Luc inverts the category of Kant, it depends on the weight of Kant. So, but Jean-Luc gave the response to this objection, a good response, when he explained that it's not enough to inverse the category. I quote, here finally it is necessary that we no longer define the saturated phenomenon simply by the inversion of the termination of the common law phenomenon. With the phenomenon of revelation, we come to the point where it is here to free ourselves not only from this metaphysical or phenomenal termination, but even from their destruction. So Jean-Luc showed, it's absolutely clear, that the saturated phenomenon is not only the inversion of Kant, what we can say, of course, because of this phenomenon of sublime and so on, but perhaps it is something else. And Jean-Luc explained in a note that the first study in the saturated phenomenon in 1992 is different than Being Given, because in Being Given, the saturated phenomenon is not a force phenomenon, but something else. But the question raised for me, is there not a force possibility in front of Kant, which is not only the radicalization of Kant, which is Heidegger, which is not the disproportion in Kant, which is Ricoeur, which is not only the inversion of Kant, even if the saturated phenomenon is not only an inversion in Jean-Luc Marion's book, but which is the night of phenomenology and not the phenomenology of night. Or, you can find this hypothesis in Kant in the very well-known, if not absolutely well-known, well-known sentence of the Cinabre. And what is the Cinabre? The Cinabre is the possibility of the impossibility itself. Just I have got seconds here. I would like to read this passage on the Cinabre, which is very important in my eyes. I can go with it. So, never mind. Ah, it's here. If Cinabre, it is a color. I read Kant. Were now red, now black, now light, now heavy. If human being were now changed into the animal shape, now into that one, if on the longest day the land were covered now with fruit, now with ice and snow, then my empirical imagination would never even get the opportunity to think of heavy cinnabar on the occasion of the representation of the color red. It is exactly what Kant called the melee of sensation, and Heidegger saw that in a course he gave on Nietzsche, in the Nietzsche one about the question of chaos. But Heidegger said, in the melee of sensation, something happened, which is the impossibility of the possibility itself. And then he said, but it is not phenomenology, and then he closed, because it is not phenomenology. So my question is, can we come back today to this question of the Cinabre? It means that the destruction of the transcendental structure itself to develop an hermeneutics of the impossibility of hermeneutics, which is absolutely not to say nothing, but to try to say what I call the resistance of the presence. The resistance of the presence, it's a text I just finished now, but it's too big, a very, very big text. I did it this summer. The resistance of presence, where the question of gift, of presence, is no more the question of resistance, but the question, the question of gift is no, of given, of being given, is no more the question of gift, but the question of resistance itself. It is a question raised by Emmanuel Levinas, when Emmanuel Levinas explained in his book, De l'existence à l'existant, that at the beginning of this book, in the preface he wrote in 1980, when he said that Es gibt cannot be translated in French by being given, by given, but only by Ilia. And you know that the Ilia in Levinas is absolutely the resistance of the presence in Insomnia, for example. So it doesn't mean, I explained in the text, that I have to say that there is a meaning of Ilia, because if there is no meaning of Ilia, I can't speak anymore. But it doesn't mean that il y a meaning. Si je dis qu'il y a sens de l'Ilia, ça ne veut pas dire qu'il y a sens. Okay? We can discuss a lot. Just to explain that this question of the resistance of the presence of the extra phenomenon can be illustrated in the question of Hegel, always in discussion with Paul Ricoeur, in front of a comparison with his conference on Hegel gave in Lausanne University in 1985. Alors why? Because, as said Ricoeur, when I'm speaking about Hegel, Hegel is an experience of a factum, and I can't speak about Hegel as a concept, of course. But I suffer of Hegel. And it is because I suffer of Hegel that Hegel is Hegel. And me, I say, it's not enough. That's why I want to write a book about Hegel in philosophy of religion and the mystery of iniquity, about the Holy Saturday. It means that when Christ is coming in Holy Saturday, in what we are in Hegel, it is not only the question of suffering, but it is a question of the resistance of the presence. So, how can we speak today about Hegel? Today, exactly what I want to say, it's not enough to speak after Auschwitz. We are always speaking about after Auschwitz. But today, nobody is alive who was in Auschwitz. Finished. Nobody. The last one is finished. So, nobody has got today the experience of Auschwitz. They all die. So, the question is not to speak after Auschwitz, but to speak what I call after Auschwitz. When I say that we have to speak after Auschwitz, it doesn't mean that we don't mind about Auschwitz. On the contrary, it means that what happened in Auschwitz can happen to us, perhaps, sometimes, even if it's not the same, in individual experience, which are experience of trauma, of sickness, of madness, of schizophrenia, and so on, the death of one of your child, and so on. So, I will not speak about the maximalist anthropology of limitation, which is, in my way, the Ricoeur's conception, which is the question of limitation. Because when you speak about limitation, you suppose that there is something illimited. But I will speak about the minimalist anthropology of the limit. It means that, for example, in palliative care, you are only to be there. So I finish and I quote this fantasy book of Charlotte Delbo. I don't know if you know Charlotte Delbo. She was working in theater, and she was in Auschwitz, and when she came back, she wrote a very big journal, a fantastic one. It is absolutely not the same as Edith Stein and so on, because there's absolutely no sense, and I finish on this quotation. It is exactly what I want to say. The extra phenomenon, the impossibility of hermeneutics, but an hermeneutics of impossibility of hermeneutics, which is not to say nothing, and not apophatic way. I am standing among my comrade, and I think to myself that if ever return, and will want to explain the inexplicable, I shall say. I was saying to myself, you must stay standing through wall call. You must get through one more day. It is because you go through today that you will return one day, if you ever return. That is what I might say, I shall say. But what she said exactly? This is not so. Actually, I did not say anything to myself. I thought of nothing. The will to resist was doublessly buried in some deep. You can't resist anymore, because if you resist, you are always in life. Hidden spring, which is now broken, I will never know. And if the woman who died had required those who were tuned to account for what had taken place, they would be unable to do so. The thought of nothing, which is not the nothing Heidegger, but in fact, which is the l'horreur de l'être in Levinas, huh? The thought of nothing, I looked at nothing, I felt nothing, I was a skeleton of cold, with cold blowing through all the crevice in between a skeleton ribs. Finished, thanks.
Rich presentation, and the time is urgent for us, so we pass immediately to the questions that you have probably raised with your speech. Jeff?
Thank you very much for your paper. Much of it resonated with me very deeply, and I appreciate your kind of leadership on kind of forging these sort of boundaries or crossing these Rubicons that I think are so necessary to do. And I hate to add more names to a litany of names that is already very rich, but I couldn't help but think of two other figures who kind of taken it upon themselves to radicalize the hermeneutical tradition, specifically John Caputo and Johnny Vadimo.
Yes.
And I was wondering how you would distinguish your radicalization of hermeneutics from their respective projects.
Yes.
Not so, too much to ask.
I just read a book on, I just read one book on Caputo, donc I don't know all his work. I think there is something different. It is not absolutely the same way. In the sense of my question is the question of the limits of hermeneutics and the limits of phenomenology, but absolutely not in a Derrida's way. And that is, I could discuss with Derrida, and I discuss with Derrida about Cora, but it means that for me, I don't want to say that we have to speak in the marge of philosophy, on the marge of phenomenology, and so on. Of course, there is a question to know if you can speak phenomenologically of the question of the outside of sense or of the extra phenomenon. But the question to know if you speak phenomenologically or not, for me, is not a question. Because when you say it is phenomenologically or not, it is only a question of orthodoxy, you know? So for me, it is a question. What is your reference today? For example, I just take an example. First, in Metamorphosis of Finitude, I was speaking about the question of flesh and chair and resurrection of flesh and so on. But then, Leib in Lucerne is translated by Merleau-Ponty or by Levinas. No, not by Levinas, by Merleau-Ponty and Ricoeur. Leib is translated by flesh, chair. But if you read the Levinas translation, it is a paragraph 43, I think. The Levinas translation of Meditation Cartesian, it has been changed in the new translation. Levinas translated Leib is a Cartesian meditation by co-organic. did that. Because he translated in 1931, he translated live exactly as we were translated live in Nietzsche. Because in French, when you translate live in Nietzsche, it is always core. And when you translate live in UCL and Merleau-Ponty, it is always share. Oh, why? Twice the same word has not the same the same translation. So you see, it is just an example. But an example to say that perhaps the difference between my work and Caputo and so on, it is the fact that I'm not enrolled in the Derrida's work, even if I respect it, and I discuss with him in the chapter, but it is to say that there is no, on one path, the author of phenomenology, and on the other way, the other authors. You have to change your reference because of what you are looking for. It means, for example, me in reading Peace of the Land, I spoke about Spinoza, Nietzsche, and Deleuze, and now I'm doing something about Freud, and I don't know what I will do tomorrow. It depends on the phenomenon you are seeing, and to say so, not to be only a phenomenologist, it is not the question. But of course, I remain a phenomenologist in the method, absolutely. Descriptive method, I think.
Thank you. The next question goes to Michael.
I have a question regarding the fourth moment you mentioned with Kant.
Yes.
Perhaps I simply didn't get it because it looks like it's very important to what you.
Yes.
Develop later. So it's about the sin over. I don't know if I remember it rightly, but I have the impression that Kant passes as quite a moderate conceptualist also in both versions of the transcendental deduction. So what would the sin over case add? Perhaps I simply didn't get it, how you brought the force after the disproportion in with the example.
Well, the force way I suggest in interpreting Kant is absolutely a different way first, which is not it is not a question of the phenomenization, but the question of the impossibility of phenomenon. That is first. Yeah, I think, but no, Kant. No, Kant saw it.
Yeah.
He saw,
yeah.
But then he closed. He said, okay, he saw it, and then he said, it's not possible. Kant said that if something happened, which can't happen in the schematism of imagination, it is chaos. And he said, it is chaos. But the question today is, how can we speak today about this possibility of chaos?
The Gebühl.
Huh?
Gebühl von Empfindungen.
Qui est vu?
Not chaos, in fact. I mean, there's something that is, there are representations for Kant that can be apprehended, but not be brought under the rule of the categories. I mean, Kant allows for that.
No. But this is only a few lines, in the categories. In fact, it is Deleuze who saw that. Deleuze saw that point, and Heidegger just in the line. It means that. It is not only the impossibility of representation because something could be representable, or because the access of the representation myself. It is a question of the impossibility of representation because the transcendental structure of representation has been destroyed. So, you see, I think that Kant saw that. The interesting point for me is to say that you have a fourth way, which is not exactly the same, and it is, of course, a moment in my work. I think if I will not die tomorrow, that I will not finish on that point. But it is a point of radicalization to say that you have a way of the resistance of the presence, so that I didn't speak about this text, where the question of presence is not gift but resistance, exactly as the id in Freud, and that way. But we can discuss about Kant a long time, and I have to write I want to write a paper which is the title of the paper is Sinab. So I have many documents on it, but it's difficult to find them.
Thank you very much, because we are running out of time. We have three more questions, although there are two others who would like to ask the question, if we can be short. First, Janes.
Thank you for giving me a new way to read Polycarp.
Mm-hmm.
But one suggestion or question. could we understand Mimesis too, a little in the way of Catholic hermeneutics, like you understand it? Second Mimesis by
Ricoeur himself.
Yeah.
If you can read Ricoeur in the way of Catholic hermeneutics,
yes.
No. No, stop to do it. It is exactly when you want to read Levinas as a Christian and Ricoeur as a Catholic. And I remember the first time I came to the Castelli colloquium, I was very young, Jean-Luc invited me, and Gresh, and I said, the first time I said, I was 20, so just 30, I said, we have to stop to baptize Levinas and to Catholicize Ricoeur, because it is not to respect them. And it is because we are always Christianized Levinas and Catholicized Ricoeur that the Catholic thinker is doing nothing in that way, and in theology, often in theology, because they always repeat. Of course, I like hermeneutics theology. I agree with hermeneutics theology. I studied hermeneutics theology during 20 years. So it's good, it's very important. But it is not the Catholic hermeneutics. But Ricoeur always said that. And he was so surprised to be so welcome in the Catholic Institute of Paris with Gresh. I thought, it's good, but Gresh knows my position. And Gresh did a lot to welcome Ricoeur. And it was so important for the French theology, because there was nothing. It was so important. It is always important today, but today we have to read Ricoeur from its own tradition, Levinas from its own tradition, and to ask to ourselves, what can we do from our tradition? And then you can read Thomas Aquinas, Bonaventure, and so on, to see that you have everything to do.
Professor Marion.
Thank you for your presentation. Just a footnote. I think you should not say too quickly the phenomenology or the hermeneutics, because there is no such unity of the tradition. As we said, you said exactly, phenomenology is a methodology for us, it's not the doctrine. So, and second, about the question of the impossibility of the possibility for phenomenon to appear. I think there is no steady grenzen, steady limit. the moment of the impossibility for a phenomenon to appear, which established, in fact, you can describe the phenomenon, that impossibility, that moment where nothing appears. So it's still a part of phenomenology. I mean, there is no steady limit between what appears and what not disappears. When you say, for instance, there is a moment when the transcendental and a priori condition of phenomenality are broken, which is absolutely true, but this moment itself can be described. And it is depending of my capacity to suffer, to receive, to endure the impossibility, that there is a new step. And all what you suggest about the possibility of a phenomenality seen from the viewpoint of resurrection, from beyond, is exactly based on that, on the, for our common capacity to see a phenomenon, there is a moment when that capacity is completely overwhelmed and disqualified. But I think it is your final intention. Phenomena, invisible phenomena, which will never appear in a neutral way, can be manifested from another viewpoint. And this is the mystery of resurrection. From the point of view of the resurrected Christ, things do appear. And we don't see them, we don't recognize Christ, we see only the gardener, things like that, because we are not yet in that point of view. But the impossibility, the obscurity of the beyond the limits phenomenon is an obscurity because we experience that we are no more the center of the perspective. And eschatology is the hope that we may go closer and closer to the new center of perspective. Not from it, no, not that there is no perspective.
So I absolutely agree with the question of resurrection. It is in fact a sort of saturated phenomenon when I speak about it, because it is a new point of view and not the point of view of myself, but the point of view of God himself. So that is, I absolutely agree. Perhaps the difference between the saturated phenomenon and the metamorphosis of finitude is the fact that Christ is not the model of the phenomenon, which has got all the characterization of the phenomenon, of the saturated phenomenon, but Christ changes the category itself. So the first point, I agree, of course, that it is a new point of view, but this point of view, which is a point of view of theology, change the point of view of phenomenology. It means that theology is not only the achievement for Gursi. Okay. And then the second point, which is the first one in your question, which is the question, how can you speak about the impossibility of the possibility of the phenomenon? Because if you want to speak about the impossibility of the possibility of the phenomenon, you say nothing because you are speaking from an impossibility. Yes, but you know this impossibility of the possibility of the phenomenon, none in itself, but because on its of its effects, à cause de ses effets. Exactly what Freud showed in the unconsciousness and so on. It means that in the effects, you see that when someone leaves a trauma, I've been in a psychiatric center for a week, in a stage, but you see that when someone has a trauma, an accident, someone died, nothing can appear anymore. So my question is, how can I describe this event, which is the impossibility of an event? So, as you say, it is, of course, not a new point of view, but the destruction of any point of view. Then, the end of that, because why I'm working about the extra phenomenon, why I'm working about the question of madness, and so on, and Hegel, it is because, at the end, I would like to write a book, which is The Mystery of Iniquity, to show how, in the Holy Saturday, only Christ can rejoin me in this impossibility of the possibility of the phenomenon, to give me a new transcendental structure to see something. But it means that it is Christ that could give me this new transcendental structure, because only Christ can create the new ontological condition of the new creation. So, and we agree absolutely. Only the point is to know that how Hegel is absolutely Hegel, which is not the same as sin. How Hegel is absolutely Hegel, where Christ can come to us to save us, but he will save a sort of Hegel, which is not only the evil of the sin, it is, it exists, of course, but it is also the elemental evil, and Levinas spoke about the elemental evil. So my question is, so in fact, my perspective is also a theological one, because I have to write this book since 5 years, I have the plan of the book, the outline of the book, since 5 years, but I can't write it. But why? Because I don't know enough what is heaven to know what God is doing to rejoin us in heaven. That's why I have to do this detour by phenomenology, philosophy, and Levinas. Then to know how God can rejoin us in the Holy Saturday in this structure.
Thank you very much. There are more questions, but probably the last one, Reinhold. Reinhold.
My just question. Quickly. You wanted to. Thank you very much.
Okay.
My question. You wanted to establish a third path between the short path and the long path. But at the end of your first point, you spoke about not the body of the text, this was living us, but about the text of the body, it's your position, and at the end of the body of the voice. In my, la voix crue, in my impression, you didn't establish a third path, but you wanted to re-establish the first one, because I think not to be able to have a sense or a meaning in the world, but the only possibility to have is to cry that there's no sense is also a thing of the of a hermeneutics of the Dasein. Don't you think so? And so I think in reality you wanted to re-establish the first path and not to establish a third one.
So I absolutely don't disagree with the hermeneutic of Dasein, because in my work, the hermeneutic of Dasein is the beginning. And when you are a philosopher, you have no other beginning than the hermeneutic of Dasein. So I absolutely agree with that point. Then the second point is to say that the hermeneutic of Dasein is not the last word, but the first word. That's why Enrique said that finitude is never an origin. I said, yes, it is, but because of hermeneutics, it is not. And then, at the end, I am in a minimalist conception, in my text on palliative care, for example, when I said we have to reinterpret the question of Dasein, but Dasein, when you are in an hospital, it means only to be there, être là, to be there in front of a body. So, then, when you said that, in fact, I have the three ways, the three paths, the long path and the short path, effectively, I am now coming back to the long path, in fact, because I accept to be transformed by palliative care, Freud, and so on. Okay, I'm coming back to Freud, to Ricoeur. In fact, that's why many people said that I'm very close from Ricoeur, because I discuss. But to take position, yes?
So it's the long path of the body and not of the text.
No. Long path of the body. No, because I'm not a thinker of mediation as Ricoeur, it's not the question of mediation, but I'm a thinker of transformation. And I think it is the difference.
Thank you very much also for your explications and for your presentation. Many thanks.
Thank you.